Hello, my name's David Dungay and welcome to UC Partner Summit 2022. Today I'm joined by Jay McBain, industry analyst. Welcome to the show, Jay. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much for having me.
Fantastic. So, Jay, let's get straight into the conversation. Anyone who's been in channel will already know who you are and what you do. Let's start with the big trends, 2022 and beyond. What are the big headlines for Jay McBain? What are you looking at?
Well, we're looking at about a dozen things happening all at once. And we've been making some predictions in previous years, both of us together, that are starting to come true, you know, week by week as we're, you know, coming out of first quarter into second quarter of 2022. So it's interesting to watch the news every day, watch these new subscription and consumption models really take hold. Every company now from the client server era has now announced all in what that means. In the UCaaS space, we're watching product-led growth with great interest in how companies are building channels and ecosystems around it, the usage-based models, the value-based models. We talked in the past about the vast growth of marketplaces and how the consumption of technology, how the money changes hands, is quickly changing to where about a third of UCaaS will go through marketplaces later this decade. A third will go direct. A third will go indirect. That's very different numbers than we have today. So the flow of money is changing. We're seeing companies change their programs. We're seeing them change their processes. And the technology that underlies all of this is also changing. Things like attribution is coming into our world. Things like data sharing at scale, escrow services are coming into vogue. So we're watching changes almost from every level, from where we've been as an industry for 40 years to where we're going forward. We're starting to see those important building blocks now of what this might look like by the end of the decade.
Yeah, there's so much going on. Now, we're not going to have time today to speak about absolutely everything on your list, but we'll do our best to get to some of those more pertinent points. I want to start with ecosystems and marketplaces. You know, for your average partner, you know, you've got obviously the numbers of monetary value going through those marketplaces is set to be, well, staggering, you know, by the end of this decade. But what does this mean for partners? Is this an opportunity for partners, or is this a bit of a threat?
Well, it depends on the model that you have. It should be an opportunity. And the companies that have big marketplaces like Microsoft and AWS and Google and Salesforce, some of the traditional companies, you know, IBM and SAP and Oracle, you know, I think that there's 20 marketplaces that are going to capture about 80% of the marketplace opportunity. And we're talking trillions of dollars in the tech and telco industry. So these are not small dollars, but they've moved their executive compensation. They moved their sales compensation over to enterprise credits. They're talking now publicly about the changing buying behaviors that they're seeing. You know, our B2B business-to-business buyers are looking more and more like consumers. If you look over in the US, one third the economy right now is running via marketplace, really driven by the pandemic, and it's not coming back. So people are taking their consumer behaviors into the work world. You look at UCaaS, for example, where, you know, it's not a singular buyer. You've got heads of marketing, you know, creating inside sales groups. You've got this new focus around subscription in customer success, you know, getting that adoption and stickiness and upsell and enrichment every 30 days forever, and building teams around that function, which is a non-traditional buyer. And these buyers are buying seven layers today around UCaaS to drive these solutions. So it makes sense that you procure and provision that in one place. It makes sense that the companies that own these marketplaces are commissioning their people, incenting their people to accept these seven layer stacks. It makes sense that they're opening up opportunities for partners inside the marketplace, not in the traditional resell model. Marketplaces aren't replacing, for example, a distributor. What it does do, though, is opens up opportunities to make money before the point of sale, during the point of sale in a co-sell type of fashion, and then after the point of sale where the real money can be made, can all be orchestrated through marketplaces. So buyer behaviors are moving on one side. You've got the big marketplaces moving on the other side. It seems like this is two trends that are coming together and come together accelerated by a global pandemic.
Yeah. I mean, some vendors seem to be moving slightly quicker than others on this as well. You mentioned Microsoft there, Jay. You know, it's quite timely, actually. There's quite a lot of changes going on around the Microsoft partner ecosystem right now, particularly around new commerce experience. Tell us about that. What's your take on that? You know, Microsoft are moving the partner value from the transaction to the sort of the adoption phase. What's your take on all of that?
Yeah, so this is one of our predictions that came true, and it's more than just Microsoft. We think there's going to be fast followers to this, and this is pretty much what you're seeing from Microsoft, and there's about five changes going on at once. Not only a new commerce experience, you're seeing a new point system, you're seeing some price raises across how monthly products work, and you know there's five changes hitting at once for the average Microsoft partner. And so you have 470,000 partners now considering how this is going to look and how they're going to play this, you know, based on the deadlines. You've got 300 to 400 new partners that join Microsoft every day, but they don't have these problems because they don't come from a legacy relationship. So when you look at new commerce experience, this is this idea that if a third of Microsoft's business goes through a marketplace, if a third of it goes direct, which for a company that sells 90% plus through the channel, this is a massive change. And over in the UK, you're seeing magazines write up some of these challenges and you're seeing some of that flack, you know, hit the news wires. You're seeing this one third that goes indirect. So the idea of a subscription itself, a singular subscription, should be owned by a vendor in a singular place. And if that customer has the freedom to walk from a marketplace to direct, to indirect, and in between all those things, you can't be moving systems each time. When we talk about procurement and provisioning in the same spot, adding a user, taking away a user, really simplifying, which you know goes from hundreds of product SKUs and routes to market down to basically three. This is a new experience that every company is looking at building. Last thing I'll say is a couple of weeks ago, Chuck Robbins, the CEO of Cisco, you know, not only talking about WebEx, but talking about all the different parts of Cisco as they're going into Cisco Plus and a full subscription model, complained a little bit about infrastructure. How complicated the spaghetti code that they've picked up for the last, you know, almost 40 years is to implement in this singular experience. And that's the number one limiter for them going to subscription consumption models faster. And again, you could assume this is happening at Dell and Lenovo and HPE and others at the same time at a different phase. But this is a lot about transformation and technology at the vendor level, being able to execute at scale.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, when a vendor like Microsoft makes a big move, there's going to be a few shockwaves felt along the way, I'm sure. One thing I do want to pick up on is on that subscription model, obviously part of new commerce experience, you know, Microsoft did sort of try and push partners down the 1 year and 3 year contract routes, and there's still the 30-day rolling contract available, but it was significantly more expensive. What's your take on that? Is that at odds with, you know, where we're going in the subscription economy, or did that make sense to you?
It actually made total sense to me. And in this world that we live in, whether you're looking at consumer or whether you're looking at business to business or business to business to consumer, I mean, whichever level you're looking at, this idea that there carries more risk if you have a 30-day renewable contract instead of a 1 year or 3 years. You know, you're buying up more, you're making a bigger commitment. And so there is an incentive to do that, which is a price. And most of the things we buy today do have that monthly or annual, you know, click, and you just assume that you're going to make, you know, 10 or 20% savings by making a bigger commitment. The bigger story underneath that, though, is risk. And I'm not sure that this one is fully vetted yet. And when I say that, you've got the EU, you've got the US government looking at what big tech is doing, and you've got hundreds of thousands of partners now taking on risk. And it was at 72 hours after the contract is sold. Now they've extended that. But basically, after a week, it's the partner, it's the small business in a small town, you know, somewhere in the world that takes on the risk of their customers not paying. And, you know, it sounds like, you know, it's something every business has to take on, you know, in their books, but this is bigger than that. If I was a small business serving retail and hospitality in March 2020, as the pandemic was hitting, that would put me out of business when I got the cancellations. And so I think that there's some regulation, legislation, compliance, governance coming that won't be driven out of Microsoft here is if another scenario like that happens. And, you know, you've got multi-trillion dollar valued companies that are throwing off hundreds of billions of dollars of profit that are basically walking the risk over to what the average partner has 8 people. And you're walking it into a small business in your town, you know, the owner principals trying to pay their mortgage and, you know, raise their kids. And, you know, when you've got big companies moving risk into small business, this is going to be an interesting thing as it plays out.
Absolutely. I mean, what does that mean in your eyes in terms of that risk? You know, if I was a small partner, I've heard a few small partners have just turned around and gone, look, transact with Microsoft directly. We'll sort out the support and everything around the edges, just to get around that issue. Do you think we'll see more of that?
Yeah, I mean, on the risk side and just the complexity side of the new commerce experience and the change that it's creating, you're seeing the layer of distribution, whether it's traditional broadline distributors, the value-added distributors in Europe and in Asia Pacific. You're seeing the cloud solution providers, the Pax8s of the world and SureWebs. You're seeing the rise of telco, what was master agents, now tech solution brokers, starting to take on some of this capital and credit facilities to handle some of this risk, to provide the insurance to these small businesses. So, you know, when we were asking about the future of distribution last year, given all these changes happening in the market, this is one area, as more companies figure out their own new commerce experience, that distributors can play a big role of insulating these changes to that end partner who's out, you know, making money and trying to grow the business. They don't have weeks on end to go get certified, build competencies, and go, you know, figure out this new scoring algorithm to reach an artificial score of 70. You know, you've got a layer there that can support these businesses at scale, you know, to what that relationship with Microsoft, you know, should and ought to be.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't know if you can hear that, Jay. It's just started hailing where I am. But I will endeavor to carry on. That's the British weather for you. So one of the big changes, obviously, this point system and how Microsoft are incentivizing their partners. I wonder if you could just maybe lay that out and what that sort of that change means, what that change means for, you know, partner models and what they're going to have to adapt to.
Yeah. So one of the predictions we'd made together was this idea that, you know, we pay everything. So vendors pay everything at the point of sale. And so there's always been this friction for decades now, where at the point of sale, you pay front end margins, there's back end margins, the whole gross to net, and it could be upwards of 40% in more niche areas, you know, down to 10 or 15% in more commodity areas. But the cost of distribution, the cost of the go-to-market at that vendor is a significant cost. So we pay at that point of sale, and you hear this all the time, where a partner does everything, getting that customer to the dance, getting that customer on the dance floor and keeping them dancing all night long, that partner gets paid X. The next partner comes along and just grabs an order. And you hear your direct sales team complain that that's all the channel does is they take orders. Because every now and then there is a bluebird and it happens. But you pay the exact same amount, the X. And all you've done is average every partner. And we know that the world is an average. On some deals, you're losing money because you've spent everything in sales and marketing and engineering and technical to get that customer there. and you're making, you know, that amount. And what we're doing now is we're getting smarter about each of these things along the customer journey. So we know that the average business buyer, if I'm going to buy UCaaS or if I'm going to go buy CCaaS today, there's 28 moments from the moment I figure I have a problem to the moment I make vendor selection. And that 28 is average. Some customers it's 100, some it's 5. But just if you think about the 28, these moments become critical for not only Microsoft, but for everyone. You know, Zoom wants to get into those moments, and WebEx wants to get in those moments, and RingCentral wants to get in those moments, and 8x8 wants to get, you know, you've got 100 companies that want to get into these 28 moments. Because those are the critical, influential moments, the ebooks, the webinars, the events, the podcast, all the things that happen there as you get smarter as a customer and move along, in many cases, not using humans. You're not going into a sales process the way you did in the past. You actually don't want to if you're a majority of business buyers. And you're using these 28 moments to make a decision, to get confident, to get smart enough to feel that you can go make a pretty big decision. And so Microsoft and others now are figuring out ways to attribute what people are doing there, to share data, because we don't have cookies anymore. You can't just go and you're not the product on the internet anymore. So they can't just go buy a data lake of where you're bouncing around before you make your vendor selection. They have to go make partnerships with each of these 28 owners and start sharing data. And who does that the best in terms of that part of the market is going to be paid directly. And so this idea of affiliates and advocates and ambassadors and affinity, a lot of this comes from the consumer world, but the technology also to be able to do that comes from the consumer world. So Microsoft's going to start paying for that. If you help them get a customer to a dance, whether you take the money or not at the point of transaction, you should look to get paid for the work you did. And then guess what? In this new world, the transaction is only the first 30 days with the customer or the first year, you know, depending on what contract they sign. But everything now shifts for, you know, Microsoft and others. You need to drive adoption or you're not going to get the renewal. You got to drive upsell, cross-sell, you know, to enrich that contract. You got to drive deeper integrations, make this sticky inside that customer environment. So there's so many things that need to happen every 30 days forever. You should look to get paid for each of those things. If Microsoft gets, or somebody else, Cisco gets a customer for life, you should get paid for that work you're doing, keeping that customer dancing all night long. So you should be thinking about three different areas of making money with your vendor. Getting them to the dance, getting them on the dance floor. Whether you take the money, you walk them into a marketplace, which happens in 24% of the cases now, or the vendor, you walk them in direct, but you get a co-sell type of a finder's fee or some sort of you know, revenue share for doing that. And then, you know, obviously every 30 days. So this is an elongated program and we're not just paying all the dollars at the point of sale. And that's this what Microsoft's really doing in this point system. That's what others are going to be announcing, going away from gold, silver, bronze programs we've had for decades, getting into more of these scalpel level programs that, you know, identify and pay for value at a much more granular level.
Well, so there's lots going on there, and it sounds like we'll have a few more announcements in the near future from other big ecosystems as well. Jay, I do want to talk about, obviously you make lots of predictions all the time, which is fantastic for people like myself and other people in the media. Looking back over, you know, the last couple of years, you know, what have been the big standout moments for you? You know, the big light bulbs. Oh, this is happening now, or that's happening now. What would you pick out in terms of you know, big trends for the channel?
Yeah, I think one of the trends, and we've talked a lot about, you know, how money changes hands and these new business models. I had said a few years ago, Accenture did that piece of research where 76% of companies think their current business model will be unrecognizable in 5 years. And guess what? We're at about year 3 or 4 of that 5 years right now, and we're just seeing it everywhere. You know, every company, whether you make cars or pharmaceuticals, you're in finance, you're in insurance, you're in manufacturing, it doesn't matter what industry you're in, every company is going through this transition. Every company is becoming a tech company. And so they're bringing in all of their consultants and all of their professional services and all of their agencies, and everyone else is coming into our space. You know, we used to have a big space of 500,000 partners. Now we have a space with millions of partners. So this idea of just vast size, when the car, the 62 car companies, as they've all gone on all in electric. The second thing is, you know, about 10 years from now, going all self-driving. And then the third thing is going all in transportation as a service. That's a technology company. That's not a car company anymore. And so when you're watching these stories take place, and when you're watching this, this has been the biggest surprise. When the CEO of Ford, you know, gets up last week, questions the future of dealerships, you know, given the Tesla model, questions whether they have the right people. I mean, there's obviously hundreds of thousands of people that work there, but the CEO basically said, we have the wrong people. And so these are big companies making big declarations publicly, and they're getting forced by their boards as they get into these different business models to think about ecosystems differently. And so we all have a place in this new world. It's a co-innovation world. It's a value creation world. It's a world of network effects now. Less so about that resale transaction, and it's more so about all these other things that are happening around it. And that's the big change. I think the biggest change that we're seeing this decade, after four decades in this industry, is that the two-thirds of every dollar that goes through the channel last year is going to not grow. And that's only going to end up being about one-third of this industry as it doubles in size this decade. And so the $2 trillion doesn't go away. The reseller isn't dead. We're not trying to, you know, sell magazine covers here. But if you want to be in a business that's growing double or triple digits, these, you know, early announcements by companies like Microsoft have a lot of data and a lot of interest underneath in terms of what the real story is. They talked last year about unlocking trillions of dollars. Somewhere between $5 and $10 of every Microsoft dollar that's sold becomes a services opportunity, a layered in opportunity that's real. And the channel, the ecosystem partners now are exploiting and exploring those extra dollars and watching where the growth is. And for the first time, we've been talking about this end of resale. It's never going away. It's still going to be trillions of dollars, but the money is going to be made in other places before that transaction, after that transaction, or what I said at the layers of technology alliances, business strategic alliances, and getting plugged into the customer deeper than you ever have before.
Fantastic. Well, look, Jay, I think that's a really great place to end today's discussion. All the resellers I'm sure watching will be breathing a sigh of relief. You know, the channel's not dead, which is always nice to hear. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. You've been watching me, David Dungay, at UC Partner Summit 2022. Don't forget you can follow all the action on social media by following the Powering Partners hashtag. That's it from me. See you next time.